this has become part and parcel of American culture, mass shootings after mass shootings. And I admit that probably like everyone, I've become numb to it until Sandy Hook, right? On 12/14 in 2012, when Adam Lanza shot 20 children between 6 and 7 years of age. My youngest at that time was 5, so just about the same age. And I thought, it struck a chord, right? I thought, what kind of sick person shoots kids? I mean, it's the next level of sickness, right? And I thought, what kind of sick society can't have a reasonable discussion about gun control after someone goes in and shoots kids? 2 days later, after the Sandy Hook shooting, I found myself on CNN talking about the Sandy Hook shooting. I live in Atlanta, and for a short period of time, somehow got on the Booker's list and found myself on TV a number of times, talking about things that maybe I wasn't fully qualified to talk about, but wanted to at least take a crack at and talk about as a religion scholar, as a minister, and as someone who I hope could be reasonable about religion in the public square. As these kind of live in studio things go, I mean, I'd been on CNN before this, but I'd never been on CNN at such an important moment. It felt very fragile and fraught, and it was way more significant. The stakes were a lot higher. And as those things kind of tended to go, they don't go the way you expect them to go because they're live, and you don't know what the host is going to ask. And she went different directions at first than I thought she would. And I just watched it again the other night, and I can see myself watching myself that I'm thinking, what is she asking me? You know, can I get it back to where I think it needs to go? And she eventually got there and asked the million-dollar question, which was, how could this happen? How could God let this happen? And actually, I kind of planned for that one. And what do you think the Bible has to contribute to our conversations on the topic? I actually think the Bible has a lot to contribute to conversations about guns and gun culture. Some of that has to do with the Bible's own discussions of violence, how violent the Bible can be, how the Bible tries to contain its violence. I think actually, like Chris said, the Bible has a good bit of nonviolence in it, or a reframing of violence that when you look at it soberly actually shows how incredibly we are violent in comparison, comparatively more violent. I've done some work on this with reference to the Psalms, even violent Psalms, and the psychodynamics of prayer, and how God's body, as it were, absorbs rage and anger in prayer that our enemies' bodies can't. Especially if you happen to be packing an extended magazine semi-automatic rifle. But on that day on CNN, when I got the million-dollar question, what I said is I thought that the Bible held precious several convictions that are significant in the face of tragedies like mass shootings. One was that God is with us when we suffer. The second was that God somehow knows, sees, listens to, and even experiences our suffering and will somehow help us through it, maybe through tools like prayer and texts like the Psalms. The third, though, and this is where I think it gets more to the point of our conference, is that the Bible contains the hope that one day God will set the world straight again. That tragic events like the Newtown Massacre, those kinds of events lead to that kind of conviction, which is, in brief, the hope and the need to live in a world where that sort of thing never happens again. But the fourth thing that struck me in that conversation and the final conviction I'll lift up is that in the meantime, it seems to me that the Bible also has a conviction that we have a lot of work to do to help God set the world straight. And that work includes comforting those who mourn, for sure, but it also includes doing whatever we can to contain violence and restrict evil so that none of us have to mourn like we do every single time we see another mass shooting.